Hello everybody. So I'm working at the Observatoire de la Côte d'Azur in Nice, France, with Lynn Mourard and other collaborators, Anne-Marie Lagrange and Karine Perrault from IPAG in Grenoble, and also Andrea Chiasa. And I will talk about something a bit different. I will talk about interferometry. Thank you. And how we can help disentangling between stellar activity from an exoplanetary signal. So you all know that there are two main methods to detect exoplanets. There is a radial velocity method, which gives the ratio of the planetary and stellar mass, and the transit method, which gives the ratio of the planetary and stellar radii. So this ratio is really, really accurate. It's better than 1% precision. So the limiting factor to have a really precise parameters on the planet are the stellar parameters. So we need to reach at least the same precision on this ratio and the stellar on the stellar parameters. The second limitation is the stellar activity. So as has been demonstrated just before, it can add noise and also induce false detection of exoplanets. So we also have to deal with stellar activity. And then we can address the question of composition and habitability of exoplanets. So shortly, I will talk about stellar parameters. So there are many ways to derive stellar parameters. For example, there is asteroseismology, which gives the gravity and the density. And then with stellar models, you derive the effective temperature, mass, and age. There is also the high angular resolution, which gives the angular diameter of stars. And we, when you combine it with the distance given by Hipparchos, you directly have the radius of the star. And again, with stellar model, we have the other parameters and then the planetary parameters. The really good point for high angular resolution is that it's model independent, and then you get a better accuracy on the parameters. And soon with Gaia, we'll have a really good precision on the distance. So we can reach 2% at this precision on the stellar radius, because actually we reach around 2 and 5% precision on the angular diameters. We can even reach a better precision. And then we can have such precisions on planetary parameters. So really shortly, what is interferometry? Well, if you measure the contrast of the fringes that are from two beams coming from the same source, you will measure a complex number, which is a complex visibility. It can be divided into the modulus of the visibility, which is directly related to the angular diameter of the star. So when you measure different visibilities, you measure different size of the different stars. The argument of the complex number is a phase. So either you measure the differential phases, or if you have three telescopes or more, you can measure the closure phase. And this is really really interesting, because measuring the closure phase is like being free from the atmospheric piston. So it gives information about the asymmetries of the stars. So this is an example of the survey we have done with Vega on Chara. We have measured the angular diameter of 17 stars and reached 2.5% accuracy on the diameters. So here the limitation is on the distance, because we only reach 5% precision on the radius. But you can derive the other parameters using models like the parsec tables from Bresson et al. But there are some limitations, because you can only measure visibilities and phase generally on the first lobe of the visibility. And then you cannot measure directly the lambda darkening of stars and the other stellar activity effects like granulation effects or stellar spots effects. But in the future, we will go toward more sensitive instruments, and we'll be able to measure really small signals coming from the stellar activity, for example, using adaptive optic. And then we can be able to characterize transiting exoplanets. So we have to prepare the coming of those instruments, or really sensitive instruments, to understand the impact of stellar activity on interferometric observables. We have to prepare the adequate observing strategies to detect the stellar activity, and also to prepare the interpretation of that data, which goes through modeling of interferometric observable with exoplanets and activity signals. So this leads to the second part of my talk. We saw just before that stellar activity is really closely linked to the detection and characterization of exoplanets. For example, for the radial velocity measurements, spots can mimic the planetary signals. It can add noise that can be bigger than the exoplanetary signals. And it's the same for transits, for the transit methods, where the activity can lead to wrong derivation of the planetary parameters. So we need to characterize and detect stellar activity. And interferometry could help for this. First, it bridges the gap between direct imaging, which is more dedicated to the characterization of white companions, and radial velocity measurements, which is more dedicated to close companions. According to Van Bell et al., it also provides the inclination and orientation of the planetary orbit upon the sky, along with bringing information of the planetary and stellar parameters. So there have been some attempts to do that, for example, with MIDI and Amber on the VLTI, and also on the Char array with Merck interferometer. But there have been no study in the visible. However, it brings a better angular resolution, and it's also a complementary spectral domain to radial velocity and photometry. So I've built a code called COMETS, which aimed at calculating interferometric observables. So we take a star represented by a lambda Cannon disk, and we analytically calculate the Fourier transform of this object, which gives the visibility and the phase. We can add a transiting exoplanet, and you see that the visibility and phase are disturbed by this additional component. So can we measure this additional signal? So there are two ways. We can, for example, try to calculate the minimum baseline lengths needed to detect this signal. So either we consider the absolute difference between the signal of a star alone and the star with an exoplanet, or we consider the relative difference, which takes into account the error you will measure on the visibility, which is related to the signal-to-noise ratio. So this is an example of the minimum baseline length needed as a function of the exoplanet diameter needed to detect the signal of the exoplanet. And you see that with good and bad condition, if you consider the relative error, you can detect the exoplanet with relatively small baseline, 200 meters. Considering the absolute error, it will be more difficult to characterize the exoplanet. So I have tested this with several parameters, like the position of the exoplanet, which affects the signal. And if we consider a spot, I also tested this. For the exoplanet diameter and the absolute error, I also derived a general formula, which gives the baseline length according to several parameters able to detect the signal. So for the phase, we can also characterize the exoplanet with relatively small signal, like 2%. So to sum up for this example, so I have taken a 1 millisecond star, and you see that on the visibilities, we can measure the signal, a signal of 0.5% for a relatively big exoplanet, but with good condition, with a SNR of 20, which is good for interferometry, you can characterize a smaller exoplanet as well as for the phase. But this will depend on where you can detect this signal. So we'll see where in the signal we can be detected. So we take the squared visibility and we will probe three different spatial frequencies to see the signal of the transiting exoplanet. So here, in the first lobe of visibility, so it's here, you can see the maximum difference, the medium and the minimum difference between star alone and a star with the transiting exoplanet. And you see that even with a really good signal-to-noise ratio, it's really hard to detect or characterize the exoplanet. So it's a squared visibility as a function of the exoplanet diameter still. Close to the zero of visibilities, it's a bit easier, but we begin to have a measurable signal starting from the second law of visibility, where even with a bad signal to noise ratio, you can begin to characterize exoplanets, quite small exoplanets. For the phase, it's the same. In the first lobe, it's really difficult because you don't have a big signal induced by the transiting exoplanets. And it's becoming better when you go from the first zero to the other lobes of visibilities. So what about a spotted star? So if we add to this star with an exoplanet a spot, it also disturbs the visibility and the phase. So the problem is that it will be hard to disentangle between both. So on this plot, you have the visibility modulus as a function of the spatial frequency for one direction. So we can probe all directions again. And you see that the signal is different with a star alone, a star with a spot, and a star with an exoplanet and a spot. But we have to make the difference between all those signals. So for the phase, it's the same. We have a different signal when we add a spot on the star. So there is the transiting exoplanet affects the interferometric observable, even if we consider a spot a star. But it does not affect the first lobe, or very slightly, the first lobe of visibility. So when we measure the angular diameters, we can trust into them because it's not affected by the spot. But we need to measure visibilities and phases beyond the second lobe of visibility to be able to characterize the stellar activity and the transiting exoplanets. This means that we need to have kilometric baselines if we want to characterize really small exoplanets, and also to have a really good precision if we want to characterize a really small exoplanet, like better than 1% precision. So there is another effect that can affect the angular, the interferometric observable. There is the granulation. So with Andrea Caviasa and other collaborators, we have made a 3D simulation of stars to create synthetic stellar images, which has granulation patterns. So we have chosen several stars spread over the HR diagram, and that are partially covering the Kepler targets. And then we have measured the closure phase of all the stars considering different instruments. So instruments on the chariot like Vega, Climb, or Merck, EnPoi, or future instruments like Matisse and Gravity. And we have taken existing UV plane, so we consider realistic observations. So we have shown that you also to detect the granulation on stars, you need to reach measurements from the third lobe of visibility up to the sixth lobe of visibility. So this is an example for Vega, where you see the baselines in meters and the closure phase for random closure phase, so with random triangles, and in color you have the Vega closure phase. We also have taken two examples, Procyon and Betacom, and we saw a signal that can reach 16 degrees on the closure phase. So with Pavo and Vega, which are visible instruments, the signals are really low. It's less than 0.5%, but it is from the second lobe of visibility. And the most appropriate instrument is MERS because it has six telescopes, so you can measure a lot of closure phase at the same time, and it reaches 10 degrees of signal. And we also wanted to see if the granulation and the magnetic spot can be seen at the same time. So we have had different, we wanted to see the exoplanet too, so start with this. So we have tested several exoplanets of several diameters or radius, And we show that so the signal scales with the exoplanet size, like it was shown with the comets, and also the position affects the signal. But also the signal is larger in the optical. So we have a better angular resolution and we have a better signal. But it can be mixed up with the granulation signal again. And if we add also a spot, we see that it can mimic again the signal of the transiting exoplanet. And it can be of the same order as the granulation pattern. So in conclusion, the transiting exoplanets are a signal on interferometric observable, and their characterization could be possible even on the spot star because it adds the signal. But to characterize really small exoplanets, it's quite challenging. So we can use timescale variations, and also it will be easier with bigger exoplanets like Jupiter-like planets. The problem is that currently it's quite difficult to observe transiting exoplanet host stars because they are really faint, and this is partially due to instrumental bias because most of the transiting exoplanet host stars have been discovered by Kepler or Corot, whose target were faint stars and not accessible with interferometers. So soon we will develop interferometers able to observe fainter stars like FRIEND, which is the future Vega. So here you have the angular diameter of the transiting exoplanet host stars and as a function of the ratio of the planetary and stellar angular diameters. And in the blue box, you have the detectability of Vega. So you see that there are only three stars observable with Vega. But with FRIEND, we will increase this box. And with the future missions like EOPS, Plateau, or TESS, which will target bright stars, we will fill the upper part of this diagram. So as has been demonstrated in this conference, there are a lot of missions dedicated to characterization and detection of bright exoplanet host stars, and we will be able to have common targets between those targets and the interferometric targets. So to conclude, interferometry can be a good method to characterize exoplanet host stars. It can bring really accurate parameters, and also it will soon have the good sensitivity to characterize so the exoplanet by closure phase measurements, and we already have the existing baselines needed to detect these exoplanets. We will soon have common targets, so we can really have a good sample of stars observable by both the interferometry and the other missions like Plateau or TESS, and we can also extrapolate to other fainter stars. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions for Roxane? I see one from Vivien.
Hi. So two very quick questions. The first one you might have answered, I might have missed it. What is the sampling time? How much time do you need to make one observation with an interferometer to detect or not the presence of a planet? This is to say, could you do out of transit measurements and then during transit measurements, or even follow the transit of the planet? To correct for spot, to disentangle between a spot signature and the planet signature, for example.
So I cannot answer for all interferometers, but for example, for Vega, it will be hard to precisely make measurements just before and just after the transit. I mean, just before and during the transit. But we will be able to. For new generation interferometers, to make measurements several times during the transit.
And did you consider one way that we had we've been able to find planets with photometry is to add up the multiple transits. So do you think that you'd be in a planet where we know that it's transiting, and you try to observe it, could you measure multiple transit to increase your signal to noise ratio and smooth the spot variability, for example?
I think it's challenging, but it could be possible. It depends which sensitivity we can reach at the end with interferometers. And it will also depend on the stars, which is a bit difficult to answer.
Okay, there's one question right at the back.
I was just wondering, with the Chara AO upgrade, how many currently that we know transiting exoplanets can you do? You think, can you do, for example, 209, 458? Is that, will that be possible with the AO upgrade with Vega?
Which is his magnitude? It's
209, four, like eighth magnitude, I think, or seven, the whole star?
I'm trying actually to measure angular diameters of two transiting exoplanet host stars, and their magnitude are 7 and 8, and they're really small. So for now, it's I think it's not possible.
Okay, I had one naive question, maybe not so naive. Has the same sort of thing been tried for eclipsing binaries? Could you use them as a test case where, you know, you could perhaps go to a bigger star with a slight, you know, slightly larger companion?
Yes, I think it has been done, but on really big stars, on B stars. So yes, we could use this, but it's not really the same characteristics. So
because the secondary is luminous, you mean? Or?
Yeah.
Thank all the speakers from.